Hello students, today we will start the next part of the chapter Evidences and Theories of Biological Evolution. In the first part of this chapter we have studied that two different types of evidences which are provided by the scientist for the biological evolution, and these evidences were from the morphology and anatomy of the organisms. So evidences from comparative anatomy and morphology we have done, and that next we have done the evidences from the embryology. Now in the next part, today we will study the paleontological evidences and biogeographical evidences and genetics and molecular biology evidences we will study. So first, we'll start with the paleontological evidences. What is the meaning of paleontological? Paleontological is the word framed from paleontology. What is paleontology? Paleontology is actually the study of fossils. What are fossils? Fossils are petrified remains or the impressions of the organisms of the past. Petrified means they are the preserved forms, preserved both external and internal structures of the animals and the plants. So the fossils are petrified remains or the impressions of the organisms of the past, and fossils helps us to understand the process of evolution by giving clues to interpret the habits and habitat of these organisms. Fossils also reflect the history of the past in real sense, hence they are the true witness of the evolution. There are different types of fossils like unaltered, petrified, molds or cast. And this petrified, as I explained you just now, that petrification or the petrified these fossils, in them the external and internal structure both are preserved in the animals and the plants. Then what are unaltered fossils? Unaltered fossils, actually in them entire body gets preserved in ice, petroleum springs and oil soaked ground. So here we are able to see the entire animal body. Now molds or the cast, they provide external details of the body's shape, size and form of organism in the form of molds and cast. And the process of formation of the fossil is known as the fossilization. So this process of preservation of living beings or their parts in the form of fossils, this is known as the fossilization, and this is a continuous process. So in this fossilization process, sometimes the external, internal, both the structures are preserved, then we will call it as the petrifaction. Some are the compression. Compressions are formed as a result of burial of plants or their parts in the sediments. Here we will study the external morphology of the plants in compression. Another form is that incrustation, where the external forms of the plants are preserved but internal are destroyed. Impressions are there. These impressions type of fossils, they are formed when an organism or its parts come in contact with soft clay. So they are also extremely useful in the study of external features of the organisms. Coal balls are also there. They are the plant organs of roughly spherical shape in the coal. So there are that many types of fossils are there, mainly unaltered, petrified, molds or cast. Now we will study further the use of this paleontology. So here in this picture you can see these are that fossils of the animal, fossil of the plant parts and the animal's body structure. So paleontological evidences, here we will study that study of fossils found in the rocks to support organic evolution is known as the paleontology. So, its study of fossils from different sedimentary layers indicate the geological time period in which the organism existed. So, we are able to know the time period in which these organisms existed. The life forms varied over time, and certain life forms are restricted to certain geological life span only. So, we are able to know their lifespan also. The new forms of life that have appeared at different times in the history of Earth. So this paleontology helps us in all these ways. So here this paleontology helps us to know the geological time scale. So the next we will study the geological time scale. Before that, one example of the fossil is there, that is a fossil of Archaeopteryx. Fossil of Archaeopteryx was discovered by Andreas Wegener in 1861 from Bavaria, Germany, and it was discovered from the rocks of Jurassic period. Archaeopteryx represent an important connecting link between reptiles and birds. So it shows reptile like features also, and it shows bird like features also. So it is representing an important connecting link between the reptiles and birds, as it possesses the characters of both groups. This clearly suggests that the birds have evolved from reptiles, and it lived during the late Jurassic period, about 105 million years ago. So what are the reptilian characteristics and avian characteristics? Let we try to understand with the help of this fossil. So this is the fossil of Archaeopteryx. It has reptilian characters also, like elongated lizard like body with the pointed tail, and presence of feathers. This is the avian character. Then presence of jaws with the homodont dentition. This is the reptilian characters. Forelimbs are modified into wings. So that is the avian character. Other than this, some other are there, like caudal vertebrae are free. That is the reptilian character. Skull bones are fused. That is the avian character, as it is in the birds. And its limb bones are also like the birds. And here its foot also contains the tarsometatarsus and four clawed digits. So here these clawed digits, they are the avian characters. So you can see here, children, that this fossil contains reptilian characters also and the avian characters also. That is why it is known as the connecting link between the reptiles and the birds. Now we'll study the geological time scale. What is geological time scale, and how does it help to study the various forms of living organisms? So geological time scale covers the whole span of Earth's history to correlate the events in the proper sequence. So we are able to know the various events took place on the Earth with a proper sequence. The Earth crust consists of layers of rocks lying one on the top of the other, and radioactive dating techniques have revealed that Earth is approximately 350 million years old. So on the basis of time, the geological history of the Earth has been divided into the five eras. So what are these five eras? We will see here with the help of geological time scale, and a chart is there. So here some description of the geographical history of the Earth, that with advancing studies on evolution, scientists were able to conclude that the Earth is billions of years old. Just now I told you that is 350 million years old. Scientists came to know this by the radioactive dating techniques. And the geological time is divided into eras, periods and epochs. There are the five eras: Archaeozoic, Proterozoic, Paleozoic, Mesozoic and Cenozoic. We will see these all eras in the next chart, in the next slide. And each era further divided into several periods also, and each period is divided into the epoch. So three the terms are there: eras, periods and epochs. Eras are divided into periods, and periods are further divided into epochs. We know that the rocks are formed by the sedimentation, and a cross section of the Earth indicates the arrangement of the sediment one over the other during the long history of Earth. Different sediments of different ages contain different life forms, which probably died during the formation of the particular sediment. So certain organism got extinct during these phases, for example extinction of dinosaurs, and those found towards upper layer resemble modern organisms, while those others which found in the deeper layers were the simpler and the older forms. So the fossils we will found in the upper layer of the earth, they resemble the modern organisms, and some other we will found in the deeper layers, they were the simpler and the older forms. So let we understand this with the help of this geological time scale and the important events. As I said you that all the five eras are there here. This pre-Cambrian era is there. This is actually made up of the two eras, Archaeozoic and Proterozoic. So Archaeozoic and Proterozoic era, then Paleozoic era, Mesozoic era, and the Cenozoic era. And let we now study the different events took place in this era. So we will start right from the Proterozoic and the Archaeozoic. Archaeozoic is the first era. In Archaeozoic, its time period is 3,500 to 4,000 million years ago, and it is given in the 100 million. This time period is in the 100 millions. So this is the age of invertebrates. So what are the key events took place in this era? The first living cell was originated in the Archaeozoic era, and no fossil record here, no fossil record is there in Archaeozoic era. But in Proterozoic era we will see that many prokaryotes, they arise, algae, primitive fungi, protozoan, and that cylindrates, they arise in the Proterozoic era. And green algae, cyanobacteria, they also arise, some bacteria. So they are mostly the unicellular organism, whether the plants or animals, and some are multicellular like the cylindrata. Then we will come to the Paleozoic era. Paleozoic era further divided into these periods. Five periods are there, that is Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, and the Carboniferous period. So let me see what are the different changes has taken. Permian period is also there. So in Paleozoic era, in the Cambrian period, when we see, this is 500 million years ago, and here we will see that animals, this is the age of actually fishes. So animals appeared here, the appearance of the fishes and flourishing of the trilobites. These are also the aquatic animals. So many invertebrate phyla, they developed during the Cambrian period, many algae and fungi also. So this was the period when the algae flourished. Then we will see the Ordovician periods. So Ordovician period, it was 430 million years ago, and in this Ordovician period, that is the appearance of the fishes and the flourishing of the trilobites, again the invertebrates are there here also, the invertebrates they arise, and appearance of the first that land plant, it took place during the Ordovician periods, first land plants. Then the Silurian period, where the flourishing of the corals, these are the cylindrates and the crinoids in Silurian periods, some fishes also, indication of the insects also, and here the primitive bryophytes also. So appearance of the terrestrial plant in the form of bryophytes. Then we will study the Devonian period of the Paleozoic era. Here in the Devonian period, the fishes, they dominate, and the origin of the amphibians. So fishes dominant, and the origin of the amphibians, and which of that plants are there in the Devonian period. So in Devonian period, the ferns, pteridophytes. So here you have seen the appearance of the terrestrial plant, and these further they develop into the pteridophytes. In the Devonian period, the plants were pteridophytes, and then pteridophytes, the gymnosperms came. So next we will study the this Carboniferous period. Here this Carboniferous period, again the amphibians, they were flourished, and the fishes also, and this was the period when the reptiles appeared. That is the appearance of the reptiles. And here the ferns. So these ferns, they are also the pteridophytes. They form the large forest, and appearance of the gymnosperm was noticed in this period. So gymnosperm, they appeared in the Carboniferous period. Then the Permian period. In Permian period, the extinction of the this trilobites there, and in this period, decline of the amphibia, primitive reptiles appeared, and the decline of primitive ferns. The ferns were not there, which were developed in the Carboniferous period. They were not in the Permian periods. Next, we will study that next era is there, Mesozoic era. So here we will see in the Mesozoic era, you can see here, this is Mesozoic era. Mesozoic era is further divided into Triassic, Jurassic and the Cretaceous period. So let we see Triassic, Jurassic period, what are the changes took place. In Triassic period, the development of reptiles were there, and this was the rise of the reptiles. And gymnosperm also, the plants, gymnosperm, that is cycads, these are the gymnosperm. They dominated in this Triassic period. And appearance of the mammals also were there. So mammals appeared, and the rise of the reptiles were there. In Jurassic period, when we see, that is the golden age of the reptiles. This Jurassic period, it is the golden age of the reptiles. Here the dinosaurs, they dominated, and the first appearance of the mammals and the birds, and appearance of the lower flowering plants also. So lower flowering plants, conifers, that is the gymnosperm, and the lower flowering plants also appeared in this Jurassic period. Then we will see the Cretaceous period. Cretaceous period, the flourishing and the extinction of these giant reptiles, that is dinosaurs. So in this Cretaceous period, dinosaurs, they declined, and mammals and the birds, they developed. In the plants, along with the gymnosperm, there is appearance of the angiosperms here, and the monocots, they developed well in the Cretaceous period. Then we will see the here the Cenozoic era. Cenozoic era is divided into the two periods, that is Tertiary and the Quaternary, and their epoch are also there. Like Tertiary period has five epochs. These are the Paleocene, Eocene, Oligocene, Miocene and Pliocene. And Quaternary period has one epoch. First is the Pleistocene and the recent, which is going on. So in the Tertiary period, what were the changes there? The modern mammals, they developed. So it was the period where when the mammals, they flourished. First, man-like ape originates in this Tertiary period only. Origin of the grasses and the dicots. So this was the time when the angiosperms, they flourished. And diversification of the mammals also occurred in this period. Explosive rise of mammals and angiosperms. Modern birds, they abundant in this Tertiary period. And then we will see here that Quaternary period. So in Quaternary period, this was the time when the humans, they flourished. So this is known as the age of the modern man, development of the human culture. And in the Pleistocene, that this epoch of the this Quaternary period, which was 1 million year ago, there was the extinction of the large mammals also. Modern man developed, and age of the man, and large mammals, they extincted. And in the plants, the flourishing of the angiosperm, the grasses and dicots and all that, they flourished well. So these are the key events took place during the geological time scale. So understood that whole this geological time on the earth is divided into the five eras. Eras are divided into the periods, and periods are divided into the epochs. And then after, the major events took place in the animal kingdom and the plant kingdoms we have studied. Now the next we will study the biogeographical evidences. So biogeographical evidences we will study means biogeographical is the term taken or made up of the biogeography. What is biogeography? Biogeography is the study of geographical distribution of the organisms. So that is the distribution of these plants and animals in the different area of the earth, that is geographical distribution. And the pattern of the distribution of these organisms help to understand the nature and the habitat of organisms and helps in understanding the evolutionary process also. So here no organism is uniformly distributes all over the world, but each is restricted to the definite area, and each such area or geographical range has specific flora or fauna. Flora and fauna. Flora means the varieties of the plants. Fauna means the there are varieties of the animals. And this pattern of distribution helps to understand the nature and habitat of the organisms and helps in understanding the evolutionary process also. This scientists, they believe that millions of years ago, all the realms or the continents in the world, they were in the form of the single land mass that is known as the Pangaea. So let we see this biogeographical region of the world. So these are the scientists P.L. Sieter and the Wallace, A.R. Wallace. They divided the world into six wide biogeographical regions or the realms. What are these? These are the Palearctic region, then Ethiopian region, then Oriental region, Australian region, fifth is the Nearctic region, and sixth is the Neotropical region. So these scientists, they divided the earth into the six wide biogeographical regions. And due to geographical changes and the movement of the earth's crust, the huge land mass broke off and its part were drifted apart from one another and moved away. So because of variable climatic conditions on these separated land masses, plants and animals adapted themselves accordingly. Now we will see that which of the continents are included in these regions. So first we see the Palearctic this region. In Palearctic region, the continent comes, they are the North Europe, Russia and Old Himalayas. Then the Ethiopian region has the continent, all the African countries are there in the Ethiopian region. Then the Oriental biogeographical region has South Asia including the India. Then Australian region has two continents, Australia and the New Zealand. Then Nearctic region has the North America, this continent present here, that is the North America. And Neotropical region has South America continent. So in this manner, these continents are present in all these regions. So the study of distribution of flora and fauna in all these regions suggests many important clues in favor of evolution. It is found that the regions with similar climatic conditions were populated by the similar type of organism. On the other hand, the regions which had different climatic conditions, they develop the different type of organisms. So there is a different type of distribution of organisms on in all these biogeographical regions. So this distribution is of two types, continuous and discontinuous distribution. Like some animals, they have cosmopolitan worldwide distribution. Everywhere they are found in the world. So this type of distribution is known as the eutropic or continuous distribution. While others are found in only some restricted area. Suppose found in Australia, they are not found in any other continent. So this type of distribution is known as the stenotopic or the discontinuous distribution. So this is the distribution of the animals in this biogeographical regions. So now this theory is supported by some examples of the biogeography we will see here. Like flowers, these flowering plants like magnolia, tulip and sassafras, they are now found naturally only in China and the eastern USA. This indicates that these parts were once connected. Then elephants are found in Africa and Asia, but these are not found in the places like Brazil, which has the similar climatic conditions. Marsupials are found only in Australia and in South America. These are not found in any other part of the world. So this shows the discontinuous distribution. Some other examples, like Madagascar is only 260 miles away from the east coast of Africa, but the organisms of these two regions show remarkable differences. So these are some examples of the discontinuous distribution of the organisms, and these suggest that the similarities in these organisms are due to their common ancestry, because once upon a time the two geographical regions were connected with each other. So these are the evidences from the biogeography. Now we will study the evidences from the genetics. Genetic studies of different organisms also provide a strong clue in favor of evolution. Some examples we will study here. Like, all organisms have similar genetic code. Genetic code you have studied already. For example, that AUG codes for methionine for in all the organisms. Methionine is the amino acid, and this is same in the all organisms. This AUG will code for methionine in all the organisms. Now, all the organisms are governed by the same genetic laws. We have studied already all the genetic laws. Then the crossing over occurs essentially in all sexually reproducing animals, whether the plants or the animals. All organisms are sensitive to the genetic mutations. So genetic studies explain how new species can be formed by a chance or by a change in the gene structure. Now, a comparison of physiologically important reactions and substances establish a very close similarities between an organism and its ancestors. That is the evidences from the molecular biology. How? Let me see that the serum profile of man is very similar to that of chimpanzees, but has no similarities with the serum profile of dog. So this similarity shows connection in between the man and the chimpanzees. Cytochromes are the respiratory pigments in the ETS, that is electron transport system, in all the eukaryotes. It is same. ATP is the energy currency of all living organisms, whether plants or animals. Blood group RH is found in man and monkeys both. Other than these, other examples are also there, like oxyhemoglobin, that hemoglobin crystals are the characteristics of each vertebrate species. And that these crystals of closely related species are very similar. Another example you can give, like the nature of the waste products. So nature of the waste products of different organism also is correlated with their aquatic and terrestrial mode of life. For example, birds and reptiles both are uricotelic, which secrete the uric acid as the excretory product, that you have studied in the 11th already. Classification of these organism on the basis of their waste product, ureotelic, uricotelic and ammonotelic. So this also provide that molecular biology evidence. Then these closely related organism have similar kind of physiological proteins also. For example, all eukaryotes possess histone protein. Histone protein is the protein associated with the DNA in the chromatin fibers. So these are the evidences from the molecular biology. So children, all these evidences, they provide clues about the process of evolution. So you read the chapter from the book also and revise these key terms, that is fossils, what are fossils, paleontology, that is the study of fossils, geographical time scale, that is the time period on the earth, which is divided into the different eras, then the periods and the epochs, biogeography, distribution of the organisms geographically we have studied, then continuous and discontinuous distribution of the organisms.